on behalf of the University of Iceland and the Global Commission on Drug Policy and Snarrotin, I would like to welcome you all to this afternoon lecture on drugs and drugs policy. My name is Helge Gunnlaugsson, and I'm the chair of the Social and Human Sciences Faculty here at the University of Iceland. It is both an honor and pleasure for us to welcome our guest speaker today, Madame Ruth Dreifuss from the Global Commission on Drug Policy. Madame Dreifuss was head, just a few points of information about her impressive career. Madame Dreifuss was head of the Federal Department of Home Affairs in Switzerland in the 1990s. The ministry responsible for public health, social insurance, scientific research, higher education, gender equality, and culture, until 1997. During the year 1999, Ruth Dreifuss was president of the Swiss Confederation. She was elected as president of the Swiss Confederation, the first woman, female, to be elected as president of the Swiss Confederation. But when she was responsible for the public health and social insurance in Switzerland, she helped implement a new policy in the fields of drug addiction and prevention of HIV and AIDS. And this comes directly to the topic of today's talk. And so she has some experience with local politics in Switzerland, actually addressing the problem at hand, the drug abuse. And since her political career in Switzerland, Madame Dreifuss has been very active in the work of the Global Commission on Drug Policy, and publicly and openly pointed out the shortcomings of the so-called war on drugs, which has been the dominant approach to the drug problem worldwide, including Iceland. She will give a talk for about maybe 30 minutes, because as she just told me outside here, that she is really much also interesting what the audience has to say about these issues. So she does not want to just speak out straight and leave. She's interested in what we have to say about the problem at hand. So she will give a talk about for maybe 30 minutes, which will leave us ample time to discuss this openly here today. And after her talk, we will set up a panel discussion table up here, where we will be joined by Helga Sif Freynesdóttir and Borgar Thór Einarsson. Will come up here to join Madame Dreifuss and me to give comments on today's talk. Before we open up to the audience to for questions and comments, and we will probably be here maybe 1.5 hour, 2 hours. It depends on the talk here today for how long we will be here. But we have the room till 3 o'clock or and so maybe it'll be till 2:30 or 3, something like that. But finally, please help me welcome Madame Dreifuss up here to the podium.
Thank you so much. I want to welcome you for a conference on a day where all normal Icelandic people are, I think, in holiday and feel very happy about the bright summer that began just yesterday. So I am very touched that you took this time to come here and to listen and participate in a conversation about drug policy. I am here as a member of the Global Commission on Drug Policy, advocating worldwide, I would say, for changes in drug policy. Advocating also, I would say, first of all, for a real conversation about what 50 years of drug policy brought to the world, how far drug policy realized the aims that were at the beginning of worldwide consensus, if I may say so, on prohibition for drugs. Prohibition with also a control saying that the substances under control might have a scientific and medical use, and that for this medical use principally and for the scientific possibilities, there should be a system of authorization. Authorization for production, for use, for export and import, under an umbrella which is constituted by three international conventions, the first of one having been negotiated in 61, the second in 71, and the third in 88, each time enlarging the scope, the substances, and for the last one, enlarging also the pressure on the control and obliging more or less, it is the most tough of these three conventions, obliging in a certain way the countries to introduce a punishing policy for consumers. So this, I spoke about the consensus. I wouldn't say that it was a very strong consensus. Some countries were leading for the system of prohibition. Others just followed. They followed on one side because the problem of drug consumption was not a very large problem in their country. It was a problem that was concentrated in on certain groups of population, better groups of population, if I can say so, in the view of the politician. And for instance, the problem of some morphium dependence among medical personnel, this was not considered as a real problem. It could be also treated if the people needed some treatment. So they followed because the pressure, mainly of the United States of America, was the big one. And earlier, also the support from other big powers in the world. In my country, for instance, we hesitated quite long if we would ratify also this convention, the first of them. And the decision, for instance, was taken, one, it's not a real problem. Why shouldn't we be angry with the United States? They are so happy if we ratify with them this system of convention. On the other side, the decision was a very rational one. Switzerland has a huge pharmaceutical industry, as you know, here in Iceland. And we thought that having a control system worldwide would allow the import of the substances needed by the pharmaceutical industry and would regulate a little bit their activities in the sense of having a better roots in the world economy. So the war on drug was not really something that the people were interested in and the country were interested in. Since the time when 40 years ago in the States the problem was considered as one of the main problems of the political scene. And as you know, the word war on drugs was invented by Nixon, who declared the drugs, the substances, as the first enemy, the enemy number one, public enemy number one of the society. So from this time, 40 years ago, we can say that we were living under the umbrella of what we call the war on drugs, which is a very strong prohibition, which means also militarization of the war against, or militarization of the fight against the production and the traffic of drugs, but in the meantime, very strong police activity against consumers. With the terrific and terrible and dramatic results that on one side, many countries were destabilized by the war on drug, as the most of the producing countries are. Let me just speak about Colombia, Peru, Afghanistan, the Golden Triangle in East, South Asia, and so on. With the result also of, for this country, of a increase in violence and increase in corruption, and increase in the difficulty for the state to have the rule of law realized in this country. On the other side, in the consumer countries, mainly Europe and the United States of America, this policy had as a consequence the marginalization and the discrimination of drug consumers, all drug consumers, all drug consumers who are not able to consume behind closed door in their sweet home and having the possibility of an access to illicit drugs, but through special system that are not the deal in the street. So for the consumers who are generally from the lower classes of the society, the consequences were marginalization, discrimination, and lack of access to treatment, lack of access also to the possibility to have jobs, housing, and so on. The misery of the population using drugs in the United States and in Europe was accepted, I would say, and the response was generally just the criminalization and the incarceration. An offer of treatment reduced on the offer to treatment aiming to the abstinence, and that was the situation. When in the consumer countries, the AIDS epidemic showed the result of such a marginalization of the population. And as you know, in this country, mainly also in Europe, the injecting drug community was the first or one of the first community touched by the epidemic and paid a very large toll to the disease and to the pandemic. Being themselves victims of the epidemics and being also a reservoir of contamination for the rest of the population, being that time not only considered as dangerous because they were outlaws, but dangerous because they were also the source of the epidemic of AIDS. So this was the beginning, I would say, of change. First in Europe, in many European countries, it was the obvious constatation that the policy had failed. It had also failed in the countries of production and transit, and this was not immediately as aware as the other element I just mentioned, but it became from day to day more obvious that the great toll of death people, of farmers being ruined by the system against them, was a toll that couldn't be accepted longer. So the Global Commission on Drug Policy began 5 years ago to think about these two aspects of the problem. the public health aspect created by the consumption of drug and the repressive policy of consumption in the consumers' countries, and on the other side, the real threat for democracy and for the society through the violence and the militarization of the war against the drug. In Latin America, the first steps were made by former head of states and leaders of the cultural life, who created, first of all, a commission to show the link between democracy, the functioning of society, the rule of law, and the war on drugs and the development in this society. The three former presidents of Mexico, Colombia, and Brazil gathered around them a group of leaders and called for a change. They called for breaking the taboo. They called for the end of the war on drugs. In the meantime, in Europe, as you know, and earlier also to this first gathering of leaders around these three presidents, in Europe, you know that in a more quiet way, without calling for a big change, but changing day by day on an incremental way, policies in different European countries came to the same result. The result that drug policy had failed. Drug policy had failed on national level, but it had failed also in measured after the aims of the three conventions, who are at the beginning convention to save, to promote health and the welfare of the humankind. So this awareness in two regions of the world that the policy had failed are the reason why the Global Commission on Drug Policy was created. It was created as a self-mandated commission. We decided, just because we felt responsible for the mankind, for the health and the welfare of mankind, to work on this issue and to promote changes. So what are our means to work? We are all elderly people, or most of us are elderly people. We could also go fishing and do something else, but we thought that we had two tools, two means we could use to continue our commitment for the people of the world. The two tools are very simple. One is to make public what we think and what we thought and what we found also in working with experts and scientific groups. And the other is just advocating, being like a salesman, going around the world and trying to speak to the people, and because we had this possibility, also to speak to government and to speak to international agencies and so on. And on the tool of publication, the result is what you have now in hand. This is the fourth report of the Global Commission on Drug Policy, the most comprehensive one. And what is our salesman activity or saleswoman activity is what I am doing now in front of you today, and the reason why I'm here in Iceland and will be tomorrow in Copenhagen, and we are traveling and trying to have as much contact as possible with all the levels of society. So what is very important for us is really, in the first line, to gather information coming from scientific sources. Because what was the great lack in the drug policy of the 50 last year is really that it was an ideological battle more than a real scientific-based battle. Just to take one example, the idea about what these substances are really is not a discussion that was based on scientific evidence, on pharmacology and so on. No, it was aimed on which categories of population use it, and are these categories of population good categories or bad categories? Why is, for instance, LSD and psilocybin and so on the list? Mainly because hippies are not people you can really trust. You cannot trust them when you are on war, for instance, in Vietnam. So people who are consuming this substance show us that this substance is very dangerous. Marijuana is the substance of the workers of Latin America. Opium was the substance of the poor Chinese workers in the States, and so on. I mean, there is really an ideology, a sociological, pseudo-sociological view that was at the origin of most of the decision-taking, saying which substance is a licit one and which should be an illicit one. So we need evidence. We need to know more about the substances. We need to know more about the human being using these substances. We need to know on the life of somebody using substances. Take just an example. How many people smoke, for instance, joints between 16 and 18 or 20 or 25, and after 25 they smoke perhaps once a year just at a family gathering or so, but they abandon this consumption because they have other things to do, a job, a family, and so on. So we know so little about the consumption, about the consequences of this substantion of this consumption, about the whole issue that the first call for us is a call for scientific evidence. So we try, because we are not scientific people in our group, and you will find the list of the members. I don't want to show how proud I am to have such fellows, but you can control in the booklet. We work with people who are more people who are making research, and NGOs who put all their energy to know and mobilize studies about the drug issue. The second, our second, I would say, position or philosophy is really to address the policy in a way that we can help also countries and the international community to see which steps could really make a difference. I mean, one can dream about revolution and the global change and renegotiating all these conventions and having a better worldwide policy. But this is also an illusion. So what we try to show is, with this rational and pragmatic approach, look what are the problem, where the problems are, and what are the means to solve them, one by one, perhaps. And this was the reason why in many countries in Europe, this one by one, step by step policy was a policy putting emphasis on harm reduction measures, on new kind of treatments, of the questioning about incarceration and so on. And I think we are now confronted, all of us, with the necessity to identify the real problem that causes not only the substance, but more than the substance, the policy around the substance, and to try to solve them. In this approach of the Global Commission on Drug Policy, we produced and drafted and discussed among us a certain number of recommendations, and I would now go to this recommendation. The first of all is really putting health and community safety first. And this requires a fundamental reorientation of policy priorities and resources from failed punitive enforcement to proven health and social intervention. This should be really the center of drug policy. What it means is, and we will, I think, develop in the discussion, is, as I told shortly before, a larger spectrum of therapies. Not everybody needs a therapy, that's the first to be said. There is also the possibility of a controlled consumption of these substances. Not everybody becomes an addict. Not everybody becomes dependent. And not everybody needs a treatment. Everybody needs information. Everybody needs the possibility, if he wants to get free of the drug, to know where these services are offered and to have a free access to this to these services. But some people need really help. They need a medical and a social help. Which kind of help? From the medical point of view, the best is clearly, and also for the people who are really in search of being free from the drug consumption, it's abstinence-oriented therapy. But there are different types. In some countries, the only type is just the constraint. Huh? No more drug, and you stay in a closed house until you are ready to go out. And ready to go out doesn't mean generally or often, or might not always have as a consequence that you are really free, because the world remains what it was when you entered this institution. And the reason why you took drug is perhaps always there. So abstinence-oriented can also be ambulatory, can be more psychotherapeutic aimed. There are many, many ways, I mean. And never forget that the social measures should be at the side of the medical one. But some people are not able to be abstinent, and some people are not willing to be abstinent. So they need other kind of treatments. There is now a large range of substitution therapy that can help the people to have a normal life, still consuming. And as you know, for instance, Switzerland was not the first. Great Britain had an experience in this sense, and France also, because they had a lot of people coming back from colonial countries who were addicts on drugs, and they invented more or less the substitution therapy. But in Switzerland, we could really show that even medical heroin prescription was one way allowing really to people to find a balance in their life, and we put it also in the law as one of the possible therapies in this case. The other consequence of putting health and community safety first is harm reduction. Harm reduction is really the way to respect the people and to say, okay, if you are consuming drugs, we don't consider that you are not able to take responsibility for yourself and for your environment. We will give you the means and the possibility to be more responsible. And this means clean syringes, this means safe consumption rooms, this means even testing substances to know what is on the market and to help the people and to inform them. Information is really crucial in all aspects of drug policy. And as you know, these measures are very cost-efficient and very effective in the fight against blood-borne disease contamination. Secondly, we think it is very important, it's perhaps not the place to speak about that, but one of the consequences of the worldwide drug control system is that it failed in another chapter. It failed in reducing the consumption, it failed in reducing the production, it failed in reducing the violence and the power of the organized crime, but it failed also in the access to essential medicine. As I told before, some of these substances have medical proven use. They are recognized by the WHO, World Health Organization, as essential medicine. They should be accessible to all in the world, and they are not. Morphine, for instance, for pain relief, is not accessible for a large, large majority of the world population. Dying and suffering pains that are equivalent to torture and shouldn't be used. Shouldn't be tolerated for people. And this equitable access to essential medicine, the pain relief, but also the substitution therapy, but also research on the possible medical use of some substances, research that was not made because they are on the list of illicit substances, is our second package of recommendation. The third is stop criminalizing people for drug use and possession, and stop imposing compulsory treatment on people whose only offense is drug use or possession without making any harm to other people. The criminalization is, in my view, in the philosophical point of view, I would say, is absurd, because why should the state punish people for something that is not harming other people? But it is also linked with our recommendation on health, because criminalizing people is making their access to treatment worse, is making their access to information worse, is making prevention worse, because people who are afraid to be punished are not able to be really active partners in prevention campaign or in, for instance, saving lives of fellows. I was in Georgia a year ago, I think, if I remember, it was a year ago. In Georgia, and this changed after our visit. I don't say that it was because our visit, but after our visit, if somebody called for an emergency case, an overdosis, it was compulsory to inform the police. So, with the consequence that informing the police, being the fellow and with consumer of the victim of the overdoses, it was like denouncing yourself of a crime, of an offense. So it's difficult to call for an ambulance when you know that calling for the ambulance will be the proof or the indice that you are drug consumers and you are punishable for that. So incarceration is an obstacle to a responsible way of consuming drugs or being with people consuming drugs. So the third package of recommendation is about the repression of the crime. I mean, the dealers, the mules, the people who make transport from one country to the other, the, how do you say, the contrebandier, the, well, the people who are going about the border illegally and so on. The smuggler. Yeah, exactly. Thank you. Thank you. And we recommend strongly to make a difference between the little fishes and the big fishes. The punishment of those who are participating in the chain, but not taking the decision, often victim of pressure from the organized crime, or victim of poverty and misery, shouldn't be punished as they are now in so many countries. So our recommendation is to rely on alternatives to incarceration for non-violent, low-level participants in illicit drug markets, such as farmers, couriers, others involved in the production, transport, and sale of illicit drugs. This has a human rights rationale, but it has also, as all our proposals, a practical one. I mean, I see in my country, I am living in a neighborhood where the deal is really present. And I know that if the police will arrest the dealer, the next day, either he will be back or his brother will be back. So for the possibility and for human rights and rule of law reasons, we cannot do more than to arrest them for some days, weeks perhaps, try to expel them from the country. But that's all what we can do if we stay in the proportionality of our legal system. Now, this doesn't mean that we don't recommend to focus on reducing the power of criminal organization, as well as the violence and insecurity that results from their competition with both one another and the states. Think just about Mexico when I read this recommendation, but the militarization is just an increase of violence. What we have to do here is a real global collaboration against money laundering, against corruption, and not thinking that the direct fight and the militarization of a whole country will help to really stop the power of criminal organization. This is a very painful aspect of the problem, the weakness of the states in regard with the power of globalized international crime. But this shouldn't make us abandon a smart and police action against them in a worldwide collaboration. The next recommendation is a recommendation to allow and encourage diverse experiments in legally regulating markets in currently illicit drugs, beginning with, but not limited to, cannabis, coca leaf, and certain novel psychoactive substances. What does that mean? We think that we have lost, through the war on drugs, the control on the whole drug system. We have abandoned this system in the hands of criminal organization. It was just the reverse about what the international control, drug control system was aimed to. We have lost the control on the drug business worldwide. And we have to take control or to retake control on these businesses. We cannot abandon these substances in the hand of criminal organization. But this is easier to say than to realize. It is easier to say because We don't know exactly at this stage, and I remind you what I told before about the necessity of having really scientific evidence and evaluation about what the new ways, the new pathways that are on the program. We have really to be cautious, to make it in a way that we can control the consequences of different markets. If we say we can begin with cannabis, is on one side because cannabis is, generally speaking, to put in the same category of harm than alcohol and tobacco. And we have some experience in this too, and we know that we have a range of tools to control. We can control who can buy, where can, who can sell, when, at what day, hour or not it can be sold, where it can be consumed, at which age you can buy, and. I mean, we have a great experience about the possibility to fine-tuning control of substances that are harmful. We do it with medicine, we do it with chemicals, we do it with food, we do it as different levels, and we have to experiment now which levels are the best one, in which region of the world, in which country, for instance, for cannabis. Coca leaf, as you know, in some country now, in Bolivia, the chewing of coca leaf was allowed. The production of coca leaf is allowed in Peru for the benefit of a big company which bottle has a form every child can recognize immediately, and having coca in his name. We have an example in New Zealand where the problem of the new psychoactive substances is faced with the idea of the registration of the new psychoactive substances under certain conditions, and in this sense, possibility for the state to know what is on the market. They are beginning only this experiment, and it will be very interesting to know where it leads. But it's interesting to know that the first result was a huge decrease of the number of these substances on the market, because they are preparing, but it will be quite difficult because the state will ask a lot of things such producers would prefer not to give. If there is the opening of a black market, they would prefer to be in the black market, probably. But if there is the possibility to shift to a system of market which is licit, they will probably concentrate on some substances and bring them to this market. So just three examples, cannabis, coca leaf, and the new psychoactive substances, to show that now in the world some countries are trying to experiment the regulation of the market of illicit drugs. And I think we should be very grateful for these countries, because the result of their experiment will help us to know what works and what doesn't work, where the results are better than the situation is actually. Now, just to finish, you know, probably most of you know that the UN has convened a new special session of the General Assembly next year in New York in April for the world drug problem, about the world drug problem. And the preparation of this discussion is going now around the world. I would say because there is move in the heads and the hearts of the people and the governments, there is also on the other side some countries who are fighting stronger against any change. But the discussion will be a discussion, in my view, that will have difficulty to find a new consensus, and this is not on the agenda, I would say, for next year. But what we hope and what our contribution might be is to have, on one side, an assessment about where we stand now, what are the results of these 50 years, to have on the second, in the second line, a real exchange of good practice, a humble discussion about what works and what doesn't work, and the possibility to open the way for some experiment. Some of these experiments are beyond the convention. I think it seems clear for me that if they are not monitored scientifically, well designed and so on, regulation of the market is not on the line of the convention. But it can open, if it is well done, it can open really the discussion on that. And for this, we should recognize, on one side, the flexibility of the convention. Harm reduction is possible. All kind of treatments are possible. Decriminalization of consumption is possible in the frame of the conventions. And the other thing should be experimented with all seriousness and the result put under, in the public opinion and the public discussion, so that we can, in the years to come, open really the discussion about what has to be changed in the convention that are discussed, that are controlling the whole system now. Last thing is to make that, it is very important that the discussion next year in New York is not just a discussion between governments. It is very important that the voices of the civil society will be heard, will be invited to this. The civil society, that means activists of different NGOs, but also, and I, for me, very important, the people themselves who are with the in drug consumption, the people themselves who suffered about from the war on drugs, the people who were incarcerated, who has lost their opportunity in life because of the consumption and the repression of their attitude and conduct. And we need the science to be present. We need to listen really to this evidence with which I began this presentation, because now I would say we are ignorant and we are ideologically biased, and this has to change. Thank you for your attention.